I'll try the hymn number 143. Sing all three stanzas. Oh, come on, faith. 143.
Father, I ask that you be here in a powerful, mighty way today. Father, just let the Holy Spirit have his way in this service today. We love you and we thank you. We praise and honor you. It's your Son's precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. I just want to say welcome to everybody. Got a couple guests here this morning. Good to have you. Those of you on Facebook, I know Brother Steve, you're listening out in Facebook land too. It's good to have everybody joining us today. Let's welcome one another as they continue to play.
Thank you.
First off, obviously, I want to give you a couple updates real quick before I even read any scripture this morning. Brother Steve, he's going to be in there till at least tomorrow. We're hoping that things go well enough that he can be released. And I know Steve is hoping things go well enough because he's ready to get home. She was ready for him to be home, too. But they're controlling the pain. They are treating him, as of right now, four ulcers. And the medicine is working, but we're trying to get his pain level down. So that's what we're waiting on. So hopefully by tomorrow, we'll have some more updates and have some more news. And continue to pray for Brother Steve and Sheila and just the whole family as they continue to travel up and down 40 and 421 back and forth to Versailles. So be praying for them all. I haven't got an update this morning on Pat. Does anybody have an update for me on Pat today? She has been moved to a regular room. Amen. Praise God. So just continue to pray for Pat and Everett. And Ruby, she was going to try to make it this morning. Obviously, she did not, but she is doing very well with her rehab and things going on with her. But continue to pray for her and Gary this morning. I want to read a set of scripture to you real quick. And it's something I'm sure I've read to you probably 100 times, so you're going to hit it 101 times. I just love this passage out of Isaiah 40. It says, "Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even you shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." Can I ask you a question real quick this morning before we go to our time of prayer? Is it not a good thing that our God is a God of infinite mercy and grace? He's an infinite God of infinite compassion and love and strength. And whenever we need a place to shelter, whenever we need rest, whenever we need peace, whatever we're going through, the good thing today is our God never runs out of grace. He never runs out of everything that he is, and he is so willing to pour it all out on you and me. And whatever you're going through this morning, I want that to be a word of encouragement to you as we come to our time of prayer this morning. In just a second, I'll have Karen play a little something. If you have some prayer request this morning, please call it out and let us know so that we can pray for it. Let me remind you, this altar is open, and I don't know about you. This past week, there has just been one thing after another, whether somebody in this church, whether in my life, there have been things over and over again that have just been laid out in front that need prayer. And ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you right now, this altar is a place to come and find and pray and have other brothers and sisters come up here and pray with you. I know you can sit there at home. I know you can sit there in your pew and you can pray, but there's nothing like the power of people praying together and having somebody pray with you. So if you've got something today or a prayer request, as she begins playing here right now, I just encourage you this morning, let's go ahead and get our hearts and our minds straight, ready for his word today. Come up and wait at the foot of the cross. Come up here and pray this morning. So I'm going to ask you if you would stand, please. Thank you. that you're already doing in this room today, Father, and we just want to honor and lift you up. And Father, we open our hearts and we open our minds to hear what you are speaking to us today. Father, I pray for those that are hurting, going through hospital, suffering, pain, trials, and tribulation this morning. Father, we lift them all up to you, whatever it may be today, Father. And we just place them in your hands, and we just ask for your guidance, your strength. We ask that you continue to pour out your peace and comfort upon them. Father, tell them and remind them that no matter where they are, they're not in it alone, and that you're walking through it with them, that they are loved by the God of the universe. And Father, I just pray that you continue to pour out that mercy and grace that you were just so full of and so willing to pour out. And all these things, Father, we just pray that as these people walk through the fire, as they walk through the trials, that Father, I just pray that you just let them know that they are loved, and I pray that the world will see you through their situation, their circumstance. Father, I pray for our service this morning. You're already here and moving in a mighty and powerful way. Father, I just pray that you continue to do so. And I just pray that the Holy Spirit be here. Open our hearts and open our minds and convict us where we need conviction. And Father, I pray for those today walking without the sun. I pray that today be the day that you send somebody, whether it's from Mount Hebron or some part of the body of Christ around the world today. I just pray that you send us to them and prepare the way before we go to them. And Father, soften their hearts so that when we speak the word of life into them, that they will be willing and ready to hear that word. And Father, I just pray that you open those hearts and minds to hear that today. Father, we pray for our country, we pray for our nation, our leaders. Father, we pray for churches all around the world today. We just want to see your will done on this earth. Father, we love you, we thank you, we praise and honor you for the God that you are. And it's in your Son's precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing.
Take your hymnal again, turn hymn number 391. Sing the first, second, and the last stanza. It keeps me singing. 391.
Thank you.
Don't I love that singing this morning?
Amen.
One thing in here it said, and I pulled this up here, Stephanie was looking at me, she goes, oh, he's going to say something. God came and rolled the stone away. Can I ask you a question? Isn't it a good thing today that our God is still in the business of rolling stones away? Is it not a good thing today? He is rolling stones away. And I'm telling you, if you're here today and you're not saved, or if you're out in Facebook land, let me tell you something. Whatever stone is there that's keeping you there, our God is still in the business of rolling away stones this morning. And that's some good news. And praise God for that. Has anybody got a word before I get started this morning? I just feel like somebody this morning has got something to say. I told Chris I might bring him up here and preach from what he did. He's like, oh. Anybody got a word today of praise to our God today? God. And I'm so glad that he's here with us. And I feel him with you, brother. I feel him here this morning, too. So, let's don't stop what the Spirit wants to do this morning. I'm not trying to get out of preaching, because believe me, I got a message for you this morning. But if you got something to say this morning, I want to hear your testimony. I want to hear your praise to God. Anybody else got something to say and praise God about this week, this morning?
Robert just got a praise
Another day, another chance to share his name and his glory with everybody. Amen. Anybody else this morning? They must want to hear me preach this morning. I'm telling you. I figured after I took y'all 15 minutes late next week, everybody needs to jump it up to say something. I'm joking. Anybody else?
I want to thank you for saving me and being with me every step of the way through the good times and the bad.
Amen. Amen. Oh, I thought Paul was going to come up here and come to the pulpit. I'm like, great for me. I'm sure. Anybody else got a word of praise?
I'm thankful this morning for God saving me, and I'm thankful for Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, God is with us.
Amen. And it's that time of season where we get to celebrate the fact that not only did he come to be with us, that he is physically present with us by the Holy Spirit each and every day. He doesn't leave us alone. He does not forsake us. Thank you. Anybody else this morning? All right. I'll give you another chance at the end. I'll give you another chance at the end. 1 Samuel 25, we're going to continue our series on David here this morning. Grab my watch so I don't keep y'all maybe too long. I put it right here to make sure I don't go over, but sometimes I don't pay attention to it last week. We began this series on David, looking at the story of David and Goliath 2 weeks ago out of 1 Samuel 17. We saw how David got offended when Goliath and the Philistines were defying the name, the honor, and the glory of God, and David did something. He stepped in and stepped up where no one else would, and he depended on, placed his trust in, and placed his hope in God and God alone. And then last week, we talked about out of 1 Samuel 22 and 23, about 7 years later, and we see a big change in David. David at this time, he's angry, he's isolated, he's afraid, he's frustrated, and he's on the run from King Saul. And that anger, that isolation, and that fear led David to make a decision that he would have never even considered before. And it cost Ahimelech, the priest, his family, 85 priests in the whole city of Nob, it cost them everything, including their lives. And what it did for David, it only led to regret. And today, as we come into chapter 25, we find David right after this terrible decision, in a terrible place, on the verge of making another terrible decision that would only make things worse. Let me ask you a question. Isn't that what tends to happen to us? We make one decision, then we make another decision, and it's like a snowball effect. It's just spiraling out of control and out of control. One terrible decision leads to another and another, and then we find ourselves driving off the cliff, right through the guardrail, right off the cliff, and that only leads to more anger. It only leads to more loneliness, more fear, more guilt, more shame, and more regret, does it not? It's a downward spiral, and it never seems to end, and it sometimes it just seems like there is no way out. But for David today, fortunately, at the very last minute, you ladies are going to like this today. At the very last minute, David is saved by a woman. And all the ladies go, amen. And I can see some of the ladies right now going, wake up. I need you to hear this message today. See, I'm saving your tail. But seriously, he is at the very last minute, he is saved by a woman. So let me begin by saying this today, and I want you to finish this sentence for me. You ready? Do unto others as you would have others. We all know this, don't we? Do unto others as we would have others do unto you, to us. It's a golden rule. We know it. And let me tell you something. This is a great rule to live by until somebody mistreats you. You ever thought about that? You're all for this rule until the day that somebody mistreats you. And when someone mistreats us, what do we want to do? We want to change the golden rule to where it says this. Do unto others as they have done unto you. Anybody else in our little dark hearts ever felt that way? Come on, don't leave me here by my hand. I'll say at least thank you, Lee. You're shaking your head for me. Thank you. So me and Lee need to come to the altar later on. Anyway, we all have that tendency within us. And in that moment, do unto others as they have done to you. It just feels right. It seems like the right thing to do, and it's just natural in that moment. You get mistreated. So mistreat them the way they mistreated you. And let me tell you something. We can all sit in here and look at me and hear me say this, but let me tell you something. We all have this tendency within ourselves, do we not? However, this is where I'm going today, and I need you to hear this. Sometimes, when we can't get back at the person that mistreated us, we tend to mistreat and take it out on others. Anybody ever done that before? And I don't need my wife to raise my hand for me because I'm sure I have. We all do that. Bad day at work? Who gets the brunt of it? Whoever's at home. We all have this tendency. And usually, the ones we love and the ones that love us the most are the ones that it's taken out on. Our anger and our hurt, it gets sent not towards the one that actually mistreated us, but to others. When we feel powerless or have lost control in one place, we often compensate by taking that frustration, that anger out somewhere else. And when that happens, that anger, that loneliness, that fear, that frustration is not just bad for us, but it's bad for others. And every one of you listening, either here in Facebook land, wherever you may be today, you know what I'm talking about. At this point, the golden rule goes from do unto others as you would have done unto you, others do to you. It goes from that to do unto others as they have done to you. And then finally, you get to this. Do unto others as someone else has done to you. Anybody ever done that or been there before? I think we can all nod our head and say, yes, we have. And this is what we do. Let me tell you something. What is absolutely and absurd and crazy about the third one, which is what we sometimes do, it is this. When you get back at that person, when you get even, when you mistreat others because they or someone has mistreated you, all you're doing is you're acting just like the person that mistreated you. Why would we ever want to act like the person that mistreated us? Why would we ever want to bring ourselves down to that level of that person that mistreated you by mistreating them or somebody else? See, we're mad and we go around and we mistreat somebody else or we do it back to them, but we never take the time to realize in our head, hey, I'm doing exactly what they did to me when they mistreated me. Why would we ever do that? But don't we do it? We do. That brings us today to 1 Samuel chapter 25. And David, who's about to make another terrible decision, he is saved by the grace of God, at the very last minute, by a woman, and her name was Abigail. So, let me give you a quick summary, and I'm going to get to a certain part of the scripture, but I need to give you a quick summary to set up where we're going today. What's happened here in 1 Samuel 23? David has returned to the land of Judah, and David gets word that the Philistines are invading a certain city here in Judah. So David has then go and save the city and defeat the Philistines. Word gets to King Saul. And Saul knows exactly where David is. So Saul gets the word, and he goes and he starts pursuing David again. But then all of a sudden, word comes to Saul again, but this time it's not about David. Somebody comes and tells him, hey, the Philistines are coming in the land over here, and they're invading over here. So Saul stops pursuing David. He goes, takes care of the Philistines, and then he comes back and starts in pursuit of David again. So during this pursuit, in chapter 24, he's going after David, and one day, Saul goes into this cave, and he goes in to relieve himself. Well, Saul doesn't know this. David and his men are in the cave. He doesn't know that. He doesn't see them. So, David's men are like, hey, David, here is your chance. And David says, no, this is the man that God has anointed to lead Israel. How dare I touch what God anointed? So David doesn't kill him, but David does go up and cut off the corner of his robe. And when Saul goes out of the cave, David follows him. David follows him. I'm speaking like I know David. Yeah. David follows him, and David goes out and says, hey, king, look what I did. I could have killed you. And Saul, at that moment, he shows remorse and says to David, I know you are to be the next king of Israel. Please do not destroy my family's name after me. And they went their separate ways in peace for now. You see, Saul's going to pick up the pursuit of David in chapter 26 again. But it happens, and all of that leads us into chapter 25. And here in first chapter 25 of 1 Samuel, we pick up the story. Chapter 1, verse 1 of chapter 25, it just tells us that the prophet Samuel has died. And then verse 2, it goes into the story, which is what we're going to be looking at today. So we pick up the story in verses 2 and 3. And in verses 2 and 3, we're introduced to two characters. First, there is Nabal. Now this is Nabal. He was a very rich man. And it was that time of the year where they were shearing the sheep. This time of the year when they are shearing the sheep, they would find out just how well things went for them the past year with their herds. And this sheep shearing season, when Nabal here, he's got over 3,000 sheep and goats, and he's getting ready to find out how well he did. If you got over 3,000 sheep and goats, you're doing pretty good, and he's getting ready to start bringing in the money once they shear the sheep. Okay? So we got Nabal. And then second, there is Abigail. Abigail is Nabal's wife. Now, we learn a little bit about both of these. The text tells us that Nabal, that he is harsh, he is evil. His wife, in verse 25, calls Nabal a scoundrel. The ESV actually says that she calls him a worthless man. This is Nabal. Bottom line, he's just a jerk. Okay? And then there's his wife. Now, Abigail, his wife, it says in the scripture right here, verses 2 and 3, it says that she is full of understanding and wisdom. And this understanding and wisdom that she has, it's going to save, listen, not her husband Nabal, it's going to save David from making another horrible and terrible mistake. And Nabal here in this scripture, he is in the area of Carmel, and his servants are shearing the sheep at this time of the year. So, David and his men, they're here in the same area of Carmel, and David hears that Nabal and his men are there, they're shearing the sheep, and listen to what verses 4 through 7 say. When David heard in the wilderness that Nabal was shearing his sheep, David sent 10 young men. And David said to the young men, go up to Carmel, go to Nabal, and greet him in my name. And thus you shall say to him who lives in prosperity, peace be to you, peace be to your house, and peace to all that you have. Now I have heard that you have shears. Your shepherds, listen to this, your shepherds were with us, and we did not hurt them, nor was there anything missing from them. All the while
they were incarnate.
Let me explain to you what David's message to Nabal is through these 10 men here. David says, while your men were out in the wilderness, my men were there too. And we were around your men, and we were there together around your men daily. And the whole time that we were around your men, we didn't take a thing, we didn't harm any of your men, nothing of yours went lost, nothing of yours got attacked. You see, if they're out in the wilderness, one of the common things that would happen is other people that might have been out in the wilderness, such as, say, David's men, if they wanted to be this way, they would have gone up and they would have attacked and taken the things of Nabal. But David's saying, look, we didn't do that. As a matter of fact, all the money you're getting ready to come into is because of my man and me. We were out there. We were like a wall of protection. Not only did we not hurt you or take anything from you, we protected you from others. So all this that you're getting ready to come into, Nabal, is partly because of us. Let me remind you of that. And if you don't believe what I have to say, Nabal, David says, ask your men. They were around us daily out in the wilderness around Carmel. And then verse 8, David gets to his request. Because of this, Nabal, we helped you out. We protected you and your herd. Will you now help us? The reason you still have everything is because of me and my men. Please help us and provide us with provisions. Now, David's got 600 men. That is a lot of provisions, and that says a lot about how rich Nabal is. He has enough for him and his family and his servants to survive and to give the 600 men. And David makes the request, please help us with the provisions. So in verse 9, David sends 10 of his men to Nabal. They deliver David's message to the scoundrel, worthless, evil, wicked man. They deliver the message and they wait. They wait for the answer. Verse 10 and 11 is Nabal's answer. And this is what Nabal answers. I didn't ask for help and protection. Who is this David? Is this not the David that King Saul is trying to hunt down and kill? Who is this David? I didn't ask for your help and protection. Why should I take my stuff from me and my family and my servants? Why should I take my stuff and help this outlaw, this fugitive outlaw? That's Nabal's response. And then in verse 12, David's men return. And they return back to David, and they tell, I love the way it words it in verse 12, it says, they told all, everything, every last word to David. And David's response in verse 13 is this. He basically says, get your swords and let's go. It's on. David's mad. He's fired up. He's going to take, out of the 600, he's going to take 400 of his men, and he's going to go to where Nabal's servants and where Nabal is, and they're shearing the sheep, and he's going to slaughter them with all 400 of his men. 200 of his men are staying back to guard their stuff at the camp. But David is mad. Listen. David has been living off the land now for 7 years. He is being chased down by the king. He has been hiding out in caves at times. David has tried to do the right thing, and we saw last week when David did the wrong thing, he eventually finally did repent and full remorse and turn back and sought the Lord. He's frustrated. He's tired. He's worn out. He's angry. He's isolated. He's afraid. David is at the end of his rope, and Nabal is the last straw, and David's ready to snap. Matter of fact, David does snap. He's taken 400 of his men to go down to slaughter them. And yes, Nabal here, he is acting like a selfish jerk. But maybe, listen to this, maybe, just maybe, after 7 years of anger, after 7 years of isolation, after fear, after 7 years of frustration, all at the hands of Saul because David is running as much as he can, maybe after 7 years of all this frustration, every emotion that is built up inside of David that is directed directly at King Saul is about to come out on worthless Nabal and his innocent men.
7 years of frustration with King Saul. It's all about to come out on someone else. So, what happens is very simple. One of the Baal's men quickly run back, and they don't tell the Baal. Guess who they tell? They tell Abigail. And so one of the Baal's men quickly run back, and they tell Abigail in verse 14. This servant tells Abigail, hey, look, David and his men, they're on the way here. They treated us well, and your husband, the Baal, he has treated them with contempt and disrespected them. David and his 400 men are going to slaughter us. See, David is about to take his frustration for the past 7 years. All this frustration, anger, isolation, all this fear that's built up and come from King Saul and what Saul is doing to him. David is about to take everything out on the ball. And let me tell you something real quick, a little side note here. One thing that I know is true in this world, in all of us, hurt people hurt other people. Listen to me again. Hurt people hurt other people. And we see this today, even in ourselves, even in the people around us. You know, my boss is frustrated, so who gets the brunt of that frustration? The people at home. Fathers that were hurt and abused as kids tend to hurt and abuse their kids at home. Not all of them, but it's a constant pattern that we see repeat over and over. Husbands that saw their mom being beat and abused by their father tend to do the same thing to their wives. Hurt people tend to hurt other people. And it's usually not the one their anger and hurt are actually towards. We do this. We do this physically. We do this emotionally. And the way we do it emotionally, listen to this. The way we do it emotionally is we do it with our words. Our words, I don't know about you. You ever been torn down by somebody else's words that they say to you? We do it with our words. We do it with our actions. And listen to this. And I'm even guilty on this one at times, and I know it. Even by withholding the affections that we should be given to other people. David here, he is an example of a hurt person about to hurt others. He is the example of do unto others as someone else has done unto you. Then look at verses 21 and 22. I'm going to read these to you real quick and explain what's going on here. This is awesome, because we all do this too. Verses 21 and 22. Now David had said, surely in vain I have protected all this fellow has in the wilderness, so that nothing was missed of all that belongs to him, and he has repaid me evil for good. May God do so, and more also, to the enemies of David, if I leave one male of all who belong to him by morning light. Let me explain to you what's going on right here. In these two verses, David and his men, they're moving towards Nabal and his servants, okay? And what's getting ready to happen is David and his men are about to slaughter worthless Nabal and these innocent servants of Nabal. And here, and tell me if we don't do this ourselves, here, as David is going, David is having a private conversation out loud with himself. Does anybody else here talk to themselves at times? Chris is like, I get it. Do we not? We talk to ourselves at times, and that's what's going on right here. We see how angry in David's conversation with himself. We see how angry and frustrated David is. And he's saying to himself, we didn't take anything from the ball. We protected his men and source of money. We did good to them, and he has returned evil to us. They will all be dead by the morning. And let me tell you what David is doing, something we all do ourselves. What David is doing is he is justifying and rationalizing what he is about to do to himself. Sometimes isn't your worst enemy yourself when you start talking to yourself? And you convince yourself to do something that you shouldn't do. That's what David's doing right here. We do this. We talk to ourselves. And sometimes we repeat the things that my wife, my child, my co-worker, or somebody else has done, and we just repeat it to ourselves. I can't believe that I did this for them, and they did this to me. Over and over, we repeat it to ourselves, and then the next thing you know, we end up talking ourselves into doing something that we would have never considered doing in the first place. That's what happens with David right here. That's what he's doing. And it's what we do sometimes. David's having a conversation for himself, and he's rationalizing and justifying what he's about to do for going to go kill and slaughter some innocent men. So Abigail, back into the story here. But Abigail has heard that David is coming to slaughter everyone and everything. So this woman that is wise and with understanding, she acts very wisely. In verses 18 and 19, Abigail gets a lot of provisions together and sends it with the servants to David and his men. Now, they just can't pile it up on one donkey. They have to get a bunch of donkeys. This is 600 men in David. They have to get a bunch of donkeys for all of these provisions. And Abigail tells the men, the servants, you take the donkeys, take the provisions, go on ahead. I'm going to follow you after you. And Abigail, she didn't tell Nabal. Pause a second. What do you think would happen if Abigail was to tell her worthless, evil, scoundrel of a husband what she was getting ready to do? It probably wouldn't end up very good for her. So she does not tell Nabal. Actually, she's going to tell him the next day. But she doesn't tell Nabal. So she gets on her donkey. She follows the donkeys and the provision and the men that she sent before. And she goes to meet David. And as Abigail approaches, she sees David and his men. Now, I need you to get this picture of what's going on here. In the Bible right there, in these verses, it says that David and his men were coming down the ravine. And when you think about a ravine, what's going on is, a ravine, you can't just have a whole group of people charging down. There's like a path, and you got 400 men snaking down this ravine, coming down to the unexpected men of Nabal down in this little valley floor. They have no clue that David's coming down, and there are 400 men, and Abigail sees this train of 400 men coming down for the slaughter. They don't have a clue of what's getting ready to happen. So what she does, Abigail, she quickly gets off her donkey. She goes up to David. I mean, this is literally, think about this, this is right before the slaughter's getting ready to happen. She runs up to David, and she falls on her face before David. And I want you, this is my scripture for today, verses 24 through 31. And listen to what she says to David. This is so powerful, and it is so important for us to hear what Abigail does in this passage. So starting in verse 24, it says, so she fell at his feet and said, oh, on me, my Lord. On me let this iniquity be, and please let your maidservant speak in your ears, and hear the words of your maidservant. Please let not my Lord regard the scoundrel Nabal, for as his name is, so is he. Nabal is his name, and folly is with him, but I, your maidservant, did not see the young men of my Lord whom you sent. In other words, right there, she said, please pay attention. No attention to my wicked, evil husband. He's just like his name, because the name Nabal means full of folly, foolish, and Nabal is acting foolishly right now. Pay no mind to him. Verse 26, now therefore, my Lord, as the Lord lives, and as your soul lives, listen to this, listen to what she does here. Since the Lord has held you back from coming to bloodshed and from avenging yourself with your own hand, now then, let your enemies and those who seek harm from my Lord be as Nabal. Abigail says, hey, look, the Lord is keeping you from doing this horrible thing by sending me. I am here to stop you. I'm here to stop you from doing this evil and wicked thing. In 27, she goes on, and now this present which your maidservant has brought to you, David, my Lord, let it be given to the young men who follow my Lord. Then listen to what Abigail says next. This is so powerful, and it's so awesome. In verse 28, she says to David, please forgive the trespasses of your maidservant. Here it is. For the Lord will certainly make for you, David, my Lord, an enduring house. Listen, let me tell you what Abigail just did, and I'm going to pick up the scripture in a second. Let me tell you what Abigail just did, so let me tell you what we need to be doing. Abigail, in the middle of this, she speaks to the future of David that the Lord has for David. Listen to this. She says to David, God is up to something great in you. He has a plan for you. He has a future for you. Question, and this is so powerful for our younger generation today. Are we speaking to our kids? Are we speaking to our grandkids? Are we speaking to our spouses? Are we telling our friends? Are we telling other brothers and sisters? Are we telling our co-workers, those that we work with? Are we speaking to their future as Abigail has done for David here? Are we telling them that God is up to something in you? Let me ask you a question. If somebody told you when you were a teenager, 20-something-year-old, or even as an elementary kid, if somebody was to tell you, hey, God's up to great things in you, he's going to do wonderful things, he's got a purpose, he's got a plan, how would that make you feel? Would that not encourage you and egg you on to go forward in Christ? Are we doing that today? Are we speaking future about what God has in store for each one of us and those out there today? What an encouragement Abigail is right here to David. And she continues and she's nowhere near done. She says at the end of verse 28, because my Lord, you David, fight the battles of the Lord. And evil is not found in you throughout your days. Listen to me, David. You're not a worthless evil man. Yes, you have messed up. Yes, you are a sinner. But you are a man or a woman. If we're speaking to each other. A man or a woman after God's own heart. The Lord is with you. He goes before you and he fights for you and he prepares a way. His presence is with you. He, David, has sent me, Abigail, to keep you from doing this. And then she goes on in verse 29. Yet a man has risen to pursue you. She knows Saul is after him. And seek your life. But the life, listen to this, this is awesome. But the life of you, David, my Lord, shall be bound in the bundle of the living with the Lord your God. She's speaking into the future of what future plans that she knows that God has for David. And then she looks at David and she goes, David, I know Saul's after you. I know people are trying to kill you. David, don't worry because you are safe and secure in the Lord. No one, until God is done with you and his purposes for you, no one can take your life. God is protecting you for something specific and something great. Can you imagine if we spoke that word into our kids and our grandkids and our teenagers and our younger generation today? Can you imagine what that would do for our younger generation to go out and live for Christ each and every day, even when the world is against him? God is protecting you. That's what she says, and she goes on. And Abigail, listen to this. I love this right here at the end of verse 29. Abigail takes David back in time when he was a teenager and he killed Goliath with a sling and a stone. Listen at the end of verse 29 here, the imagery of what she uses and what she says here. And Abigail says, in the lives of your enemies he shall sling out as from the pocket of a sling. See, just her saying that, she knows. Everybody in Israel knows how David killed Goliath in chapter 17. Pull out a sling, pull out one rock, and the battle's over. Boom, it's done and gone. And here she uses this imagery. She takes David back to the past and says, look how faithful God has been to you in the past. Look how he strengthened you. What do you think he's going to do for you in the future? Abigail speaks to David's future. And it gets even better right here in verses 30 and 31. Listen to this. Abigail says, and it shall come to pass. David, this is certain. It's going to happen. When the Lord has done for my Lord, according to all the good that he has spoken concerning you, and he has appointed you ruler over Israel, when the Lord does what he said he was going to do in and through you, that this what you're about to do, David, this terrible decision, that there will be no grief to you, nor offense of heart to my Lord, either that you have shed blood without cause, or that my Lord has avenged himself. But when the Lord has dealt with my Lord, you, David, then remember your maidservant. Basically, let me just sum up what she's saying right here. She's saying, look, David, I'm here before you to stop you from taking your anger and your frustration out on my worthless husband. Yeah, he probably deserves it, but he doesn't deserve it from you, David. God has something great in store for you. Don't do this thing. Don't pay back evil for evil. When the Lord sets you as king over all of Israel, David, you don't want this on your conscience. He has promised great things in and through you. Don't do it, David. Abigail stepped in at the very last second, right when the men were coming down the ravine and they were ready to slaughter the men. She steps in. And you ready for this? I love this. She prevents unnecessary death. Don't forget that, because I'm going to come back to it here in just a minute. She prevents unnecessary death. And David's response in verses 32 through 35, just sum it up real quickly. Blessed be the Lord that sent you to me to stop me, Abigail. Blessed are you, Abigail, for your wisdom and your understanding and your advice. I was going to slaughter all of them, all, but God sent you to stop me. And so David, he received the gift from Abigail, and he sent her back home to Nabal. Quick summary of the rest of chapter 25, just a couple sentences. Abigail returns home to her husband, and he's celebrating. And the reason he's celebrating is because he's going to have a lot of money. It's a festive time. And Nabal, he's drunk. He's just drunk. So what Abigail does, she waits until the next morning, and then when it's all worn off, she tells Nabal what she did. And the scripture says, Nabal's heart died within him and became as a stone. What a lot of people, what most scholars think happened right here is that pretty much Nabal had a stroke. And for the next about 10 days that he is in this paralyzed state, because in about 10 days the Lord took Nabal's life from him. David hears of Nabal's death, and he sends men to Abigail, sends a message, and what ends up happening is David and Abigail end up getting married. Now, I would say the end and happily ever after. But one thing we know for sure is very simple. If you're married to more than one person, there is no happy ever after. Amen? We know that. My wife's looking at me like, you better believe it, brother. That's the story for today. And I want to close up today making two points and with two questions real quick. That's the story of Abigail and David. So the first question I have for you today is this. Who's your Abigail? Who is your Abigail? Listen to me. Who is it that speaks life into your life? Who sees your God-given potential and sees past all your foolishness? Who says to you, God has a purpose and a plan for you? He's going to do a great work in and through you. Don't do what you're considering. Don't go down this path that you are on. It only ends in hurt, anger, frustration, and regret. Don't do it. This Abigail that you have, they say, I love you too much to see you throw it all away. I love you too much to see you go through what you will go through if you go down this path. Let me tell you something. You can sit out there, and I'm just going to say this real quick. You can sit out there in Facebook land, and you can sit here and say, I can love the Lord and praise the Lord from my house, and I can have a personal relationship with the Lord from my house and never enter into a church. You're right, you can, but you're never going to experience God fully unless you're around God's people. We need our Abigails, and there are people in here that need an Abigail. We all need our Abigails. We need our Abigails to speak to us, speak life into us, that encourage us and lift us up and say, God's up to something in you. So my question is, who is your Abigail? And in many cases, I don't know about you, but personally for me, I have more than one Abigail. If I don't have many different people speaking life into me, I can get frustrated and I can be ready to quit in a heartbeat. Anybody else ever felt that way? They just get frustrated, tired, and they're at the end of the rope and they are just done. We need our Abigails. So my question for the first question is very simple. Who is your Abigail? I want to tell you and I want to share with you who my first Abigail is. My first Abigail is not my wife. It's not my child. It's not my mom. It's not a friend. It's not a co-worker. My first Abigail is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. See, when I have the Lord Jesus Christ, he's going to give me my other Abigails. He's going to give me people that speak life into me. We need to listen to Jesus Christ. He's going to guide us along the way. Listen to me. When you turn to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, he's going to provide, look at this, he's provided me with all of y'all as my Abigails today. I need you just as much as you need me. And listen, here in 1 Samuel, I love this, I told you I was going to come back to it. In 1 Samuel 25, this Abigail, in this story, she prevents unnecessary death. Let me tell you something, when Jesus Christ died on the cross, he prevented your unnecessary death, eternal death, separation from God forever. He died so that you could live. And oh, my prayer today is very simple. If you're here today, if you're out on Facebook, wherever you are, if you listen to this a later time, I just pray today that if you have not put your trust in Jesus Christ, he is here to prevent unnecessary death, separation from him in your life. He died and he rose again. And let me tell you something. I say it. I'm going to keep saying it. God chose you. He chose you. He looked down at your sin and everything that you're going through and everything that you have done in your past. And God looked at you and he said, I love you. I choose this one, this one, this one. I want them to be my own. I know what all baggage they have. But God said, I choose you. And when you choose and decide to follow him, he's going to provide those Abigails in your life to help lead and guide the way. My question is very simple. Who is your Abigail? Have you told somebody that they are your Abigail today? Do they know what you have meant to them and what you've done for them and how you spoke life into them? Here in a minute, when we have our time of all invitation, I'm going to ask if you have an Abigail that you haven't told them that, tell them that they are your Abigail, that they have spoke life into you, they have been an encourager to you. We all need our Abigails, and even a bigger question to end on today is this. Who's your Abigail? And then question number two, who needs you to be their Abigail today? Think about that. Who needs you to be their Abigail? We all need them. And Jesus provided who we needed right when we needed them. And now it's your turn. It's your turn to be an Abigail to somebody else. And if you don't like, guys, if you don't like being called Abigail, call yourself Andy then, I guess. I don't know. But it's your turn to be an Abigail to somebody else. Listen, when God pours out his mercy and grace upon you, he entrusts you with that mercy and that grace to be a good steward and extend mercy and grace to others. And it's not, listen to this, it's not about who deserves mercy and grace. Because if it was only about who earned God's mercy and grace, none of us would receive it. None of us. It doesn't matter who it is. Somebody needs you to be their Abigail today. Somebody needs you to speak life. Maybe they are a Christian. Maybe they just need an encouragement. Maybe they've never turned to the Lord Jesus Christ. And maybe that person that you would never talk to, that doesn't act like you, talk like you, dress like you, do anything like you, maybe that person needs you to hear, needs you to speak a word of life into them today. Somebody needs you to be their Abigail today. Somebody. So the question is, who needs you to be their Abigail today? Those are our two questions today as I close up right here. Who's your Abigail? Are you being someone's Abigail today? And I want to say this as I begin to close up. Keep your eyes open. Because at those dark times when it looks like it's tough and things just aren't going very well and you have nobody around you, keep your eyes open for those Abigails. God will provide one. He's not going to leave you there by yourself. Also, keep your eyes open for those that need you to be their Abigail today. Two-thirds of the world do not consider themselves to be Christians. 4.5 billion today are walking without the Lord Jesus Christ. You don't tell me that somebody out there doesn't need you to be an Abigail to them today. Somebody needs you to be their Abigail. Speak life into the life of others. We need to hear from others, and we need to tell others that God has a plan and purpose. Our young people, our children, our younger generation, and the world that they're living in today, that whatever they dream, they're told whatever they can dream, they can do it. That's a false theology. Whatever God has in store for them, they can do it. That's what they should be saying. That's what it is. Speak life into the life of others. We need to hear from others. We need to tell others. We need to tell others that God has a purpose. He has a plan. He has a future for you. So as I begin to close up, very simple. What I want us to do in this time of closing, yes, if you need to offer it, is here. But here's what I want you to do. Is there somebody in here today that has been an Abigail to you today? If there is, have you told them? Have you literally gone up and told them, thank you for the words of life. Thank you for being my Abigail. I want to encourage us today, as she begins playing here in just a minute, I want to encourage us. Let's get up and let's move and let's go tell somebody, you have been Abigail in my life. You have spoke life. You have spoke the word into me. You have encouraged me. You have spoken into my future. And because of you, I am where I am today. I encourage you to do that. Do you know somebody that needs you to be an Abigail to them today? Come up here and pray for them. Ask the Lord to go before you, prepare the hearts and prepare the minds. Open them up so that they can hear the word when you go to them. That's my invitation today. My invitation is very simple. Go tell somebody that's your Abigail. Number two, be somebody's Abigail and pray for them. Who's your Abigail? Be somebody's Abigail. Father, we love you, we praise you, and we honor you. And Father, I just thank you for the people that are in my life today. And I thank you for the people that you have sent my way so that I can speak that word of life, that gospel of Jesus Christ into their lives. And Father, I just pray that you use us and mold us into the image of your Son each and every day. And just give us the words to speak. And Father, we love you, we thank you, we praise and honor you, as we always say. And it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Please stand. 390 in the broad. Who's your Abigail?
for those people that God is working in, that you need to be an Abigail to. That's my encouragement for you today. Gary, would you close us in a prayer today?
Father, well, thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be in your house this morning, Lord. Robert, Lord, as he is preached, we just ask you, God, that you just special bless him, Father. We ask Steve, Lord, and his family, and just ask you, God, that you just guide the doctors with him, Lord, that you just help them understand and know, Lord, and that's God that needs to be done. And Father, Lord, for the other ones that are sick, Pat, Lord, and others, God, we just ask you, God, that you just heal, Father, Lord, and encourage and do that, Lord, that they need, not only today, but each and every day. Thank you, Jesus, for the love that you show to us, Lord. Just help us, God, to allow you to lead and direct our lives, God, that. Thank you, Lord, once again, for this day. It's my precious holy name we do pray. Amen.
Love y'all. Have a great week.